Hey, everybody. Good afternoon. We're here to talk about some games user research lessons learned from a couple of games that we've worked on. So the title of our talk is Lessons from Mars and the Last Star. We're going to be talking about Doom and Battleborn.
And space.
Yeah. So a little bit about us.
So hi, I'm Stephanie Puri. I'm the user research manager over at id Software.
And I'm John Cohen. I'm the user research manager over at Gearbox Software. And in fact, my entire team is here today. So if you want to advance the slide. So yes, the team is here. And this is quick images of our user research facility. We're very proud of this facility at our headquarters in Frisco, Texas. It's a brand new facility that we're still kind of working on knocking out all the kinks and decorating it. But we're very happy with what we have.
And I have some information about my team as well. I've Mason here with me. I've got two guys back at the lab. I would have included a picture of our lab, but we're still recovering from the demon invasion from Doom, and it's just really, really messy right now. You guys don't want to see that.
So you may be wondering why the two of us are sharing a stage today. We're talking about separate games, separate studios, but in fact, we have some similar experiences and challenges coming off of these large games that actually forced our respective labs to innovate methodologically from what we were normally used to testing. We wanted to share a Q&A stage because of our shared experiences and kind of double team and answer questions from everybody here in the audience today. And if anybody's ever been to one of the Games User Research roundtables that Jordan Lin here in the front has managed at GDC, you know that we tend to talk a lot. So today we figured, hey, if we can get a captive audience where none of you can leave, then we can talk a little bit more.
Yeah, and not only do we talk a lot in the roundtables, but our labs are like 20 minutes away from each other, so we have a very similar set of testers in our tester pool.
And we tend to hang out.
Yeah.
So
first, I'm going to go ahead and talk about Doom, if that's all right with you, John.
Absolutely. I'm going to go hang out over here.
All right. So in 2016, we shipped Doom. Some of you may have heard of it. For those of you who are not familiar with Doom, original game was released in 93 as a set of shareware. I actually remember going to the convenience store and buying a $5 money order, sending it in for my floppy disks. It was a very important game to me in my childhood, so I was completely freaked out when we started testing Doom. Lots of high expectations, and if our players were anything like me, I had a lot of things I expected from the game that I didn't really know how to express, because that was one of my favorite games as a teenager. The game had a huge impact on the popularity of gaming and culture. It helped define what the modern FPS is, and it also pioneered networked multiplayer gaming, online distribution, and it was one of the first games to release a full set of mod tools. There's three challenges that I would like to focus on today. First one will be understanding our customers' expectations. Second will be talking about navigation and player guidance and how to go against some of the franchise conventions, and also user-generated content in Doom. So first, I'd like to talk about our customer expectations. When we ask ourselves, what is Doom? It's a game about mobility. It's known for being fast-paced, having fluid combat. There's no cover, there's no reloading, no hesitation. You kill demons with guns and occasionally a chainsaw. Both our testers and our team, that's where we had consensus. We agreed that's what Doom should be. But we realized there were two different types of Doom players that were coming into our lab. One set was the classic Doom players. Those were the players that grew up with Doom 1 and 2, typically an older demographic and played on PC. They had a different expectation. They wanted fast-paced combat, tons of demons, maze-like maps, lots of secrets in hidden areas. And then we had our horror Doom players. Those were the people who came from playing Doom 3. They may have skipped the first two games because they were too young or just didn't get into PC gaming. They expected more horror elements, tense environments, lots of dark hallways, jump scares, a lot of the things you expect in a survival horror game, not an action shooter. Those were also our younger gamers. They grew up playing on console rather than PC. So we really had to pay attention to what perspective our feedback was coming from. When we ask ourselves, where does this expectation come from? Is it Doom or Doom 3? What was that player's perspective? Why are they giving us these pieces of feedback? On this slide, I've got a couple of quotes that we got from playtesters that fall into those two primary groups. We knew that we had a good idea of what classic Doom should be, but how do we incorporate some of those elements from Doom 3? How do we balance that? Especially when those two expectations tend to conflict with each other. Also, how do you deal with new players? How do you introduce a modern shooter audience to a game that has that classic style of gameplay, that's not known for guiding the player, not known for telling them what their next objective is? This was something we had to consider not only when developing methodologies for testing, but also while analyzing our feedback. Over the course of testing Doom, we had 515 unique players come through. We did call some of them back, especially if players were overly negative about certain features or aspects of the game. That way, as we made changes and iterated, we could see how it retested. We did 32 total short studies, and then 8 longitudinal studies where we did some combination of campaign, multiplayer, and user-generated content testing. The longitudinal studies would last somewhere between a week or 2 weeks. I broke down what the different expectations are. I'm not going to read my chart. But as you can see, there were some distinctions between our older and our younger players and what their experience with the franchise was. We were very thankful that we worked with a good development team that took these two perspectives into consideration. They understood when to incorporate feedback and when to take our suggestions, and also when to push back because it didn't quite align with what their vision of the game was. Sometimes our feedback didn't need to drive change. It was just there for information. So the takeaway from this challenge, your players may see things differently. Just try to understand why they're coming at you with those different perspectives. Adapt how you ask questions and try to understand where that perspective is coming from. Next challenge I want to talk about is player navigation and player guidance. Historically, Doom did not hold the player's hand. The two maps that I've got shown on this slide, the blue flashing areas are secret areas. You found those by running against walls and just mashing that space bar, hoping that you were pushing on a wall that had a secret. When we started asking our players to describe how they navigate Doom, I mean, I tried to summarize this and I couldn't. I found the perfect quote. Part of the challenge is navigation. So how do you teach players how to navigate your game without completely taking that challenge from them? Something that relates to our testing on Doom is when we had Wolfenstein The New Order come through the lab. This was another one of those classic franchises that isn't known for having a lot of the elements we are accustomed to in modern shooters. They have lighting cues, they have waypoints, mini-maps, some form of visual breadcrumbing that guides the player to their next objective. So how do you go against your established franchise conventions there? Well, at QuakeCon in 2014, we gave the world their first look at Doom. We had the dev team play through a map called Meltdown. It's the third mission in the game, and they went through the map in about 20 minutes. Well, we started playtesting and we realized that our players don't get through the map in 20 minutes. They didn't get through it in 45 minutes. The average player would take 90 minutes to get through the same map that our dev team could run through in 20 to 30. Some players spend up to 3 hours in that map. That is not good. That's not good at all. We knew that combat would push the player forward, so they understood where to go if they were moving linear through the map. But how do you address looking for secrets and hidden areas? Well, if players follow combat, they miss that. Players were becoming lost when they tried to explore. They knew that there were secrets and hidden areas, and it just added to their frustration when they would try to engage in those systems. When we asked players what they wanted, most common suggestions were, I want waypoints, or I want a mini-map on screen. If we guide players too much, it takes away that challenge of them exploring the map on their own and feeling good and rewarded for finding a secret area. First thing that we tried, let's just make the ledges thinner. That looks like something I can grab and climb up. Let's remove the railings. It told players that they needed to go that direction in the sense that they could access that area, but it didn't clearly communicate that that was the correct way to go. They could be going towards a secret, they could be going towards the next objective. This was the final version that we shipped with. We added green lights. It seems like a really simple solution to a complex problem, and sometimes simple solutions are the best thing to do. It was subtle, it made sense in context of the environment, and it's a clear indicator that the player is going the correct direction. It wasn't just the green lights. We also added some other modern shooter things like waypoints on the compass. It has a waypoint telling you how far away your objective is, also tells you if it's above or below you. This way players knew to look for green lights above or below. We added lighting to draw attention to different areas in the map that players could explore. And of course, more green lights. The best thing about that solution with the green lights is it worked everywhere. It works on the surface of Mars. It even worked in Hell. We put green candles in green flames. Players naturally learned to look through that, so it didn't matter which environment they were in. Look for green, go that direction. So the takeaways from this challenge, it's fine to go against franchise conventions. Just create a clear visual language. Keep it simple. Be consistent with what you do. The last challenge I want to talk about is user-generated content in Doom. We shipped with a set of tools called SnapMap. Now, if you're familiar with the history of Doom modding, we are known for releasing a full set of dev tools. With console gaming, you can't really do that. So we wanted something that worked on both console and on PC. We wanted to give experienced modders and content creators some robust tools to make cool stuff with, but something that was also intuitive for novice players. So if you've never built a map, you can open this tool set and make something that looks cool. With SnapMap, there's two basic ways to edit. There are blueprint mode, which is where you create your basic map, and there's object mode, and that's where you put logic or do advanced editing to your map. When we started testing SnapMap, we had no tutorials. We didn't even have buttons on the screen. You just kind of load into this environment and start pushing buttons and hoping it worked. Well, we wanted a structure for how to test that, so we printed out checklists, handed it to the player. Here is a controller sheet. Here is a list of things we want you to do. Ask us questions when you get confused. That was great because the design team didn't have to implement anything for it. We were able to just put something together the day of the test, modify it as we needed. So we asked players, what's intuitive when you're placing pieces in the map? Where do you need tutorials? What terminology is confusing to you? And we used that to build our first set of tutorials. We wanted to make sure that everybody understood the terminology. Some of it was very technical. If you've ever taken a CS course, you probably know what a relay is, or a Boolean, or what logic means. If you're 12 and you've never done any of those types of courses, and you buy this game on console, or your parents buy this game for you on console, where do you start? So after the first couple of tests, we felt that we had a pretty good idea of how to teach people to work with these advanced systems. This was the tutorial that we ran in our fourth round of playtesting. At this point, we had done several tests where there were no tutorials implemented in game. And we felt we had a pretty good idea of what information players needed. So we showed them the buttons on screen, and we gave them a checklist, very similar to what we did with our handouts in the lab. The problems we ran into with this is they still didn't understand what steps were necessary to complete different actions. So we just asked players, what do you need? Well, they wanted more information on how to complete these steps, not just the two separate pieces, the step and the buttons they needed to push. After a couple iterations, we were ready to put the next version of this in front of players. And this one is from our eighth round of SnapMap testing. We went to a system where we gave them more detailed instructions, and we only showed them one step at a time. We also moved the buttons down to the bottom of the screen to reduce the amount of clutter that was blocking their view. So again, we asked players, what information is missing? What do you feel like you need? The problems we were running into with this, players understood what to do to complete that step, but they didn't remember what they had previously done. They also didn't know which buttons worked with the specific piece that they were editing with. Do all of the buttons on screen work, or do some of those not have functionality with this particular piece? The final version that we shipped with looks like this. We reduced the amount of clutter on screen by only showing the player the buttons that they needed to press. If it doesn't have functionality with this particular editing mode, it doesn't appear on screen. We also gave them one step of their revision history. That way, if the player happened to just push buttons and figure out how to complete the tutorial, they still knew what buttons they pushed. So this worked well for teaching players basic editing. How do we handle advanced editing? Before I go into that, there's a couple things that we use to track players and their understanding. There were three sets of questions that we used to determine, do players actually understand this tutorial? Basically, can you read the buttons? Do you know what the text is telling you to do? And also, how difficult was it? Players would report difficulty of the different tutorials, and we could adjust and either break things down into smaller steps or give them more detailed or even less detailed instructions where they needed it. So I said we wanted to do something that allowed players more advanced logic editing. One thing that we did for that is rather than developing intricate tutorials to teach them how to do logic, we went back to the pen and paper checklist system. We handed out papers to testers and said, here is a list of things that you need to do. Once you complete the basic tutorial, try to do these. This particular challenge that I've got a screenshot of, it was the AI filter challenge. Basically, as the player progresses through more difficult combats, based on how they perform, it would give them either more difficult or less difficult sets of enemies. And that was all driven by systems that a normal gamer set up in their game. We found out that if we got too technical with players, it made them feel dumb and they got frustrated. They felt like it was them, not the game. If we were too simple with it, players would grasp things on the surface level, but they didn't understand how to take those systems and apply it to more complex cases for it. By the time we were finished teaching all the tutorials and teaching players how to use logic, someone who has never opened a game editor was able to come in and not only build a visually interesting map, but they were able to control how many enemies spawn, does the difficulty increase, does the room lock down after an enemy spawns, do they have a boss fight after a set of enemies. The last step that we implemented to help reinforce this is when you complete a tutorial, just like when you complete a map, it gives you a success screen. On that screen, it tells you that you've completed it, and it recaps the lesson that you've learned. The takeaway with this, test early and trust your player feedback. If you don't have something in game, that doesn't mean you can't test. Be creative with your testing solutions. Let your tutorials drive your usability tests. If players don't understand something, you have a set of clear test cases there. You know what they don't understand. And if you ask them, just ask directly, how can we better explain this to you? Let them fail, and let them explain to you why they believe they failed. So to recap my three challenges, we had to adapt our methodologies as we tested each of these different features in our game. We had to understand what type of customer we were dealing with and how that would impact the feedback they would give us. With navigation and player guidance, don't be afraid of change. Sure, it goes against conventions, but it was effective. And with user-generated content, tutorials function as natural usability test cases, and let your players tell you where they're struggling. Don't be afraid to let them fail. That's the only way you're going to ensure that they're building on their knowledge. I think I've been talking long enough. We'll let John talk about a game.
Hi, folks. Let me get my water. All right. So now I'm going to talk a little bit about Battleborn. So Battleborn was a unique game for Gearbox Software, not just for the development team, for what they were creating, but also for the user research team. Because you know we were coming off of testing a large open world game like Borderlands, the pre-sequel, Borderlands 2, and we kind of knew how to test that. But this game afforded us an opportunity to innovate in a variety of ways that helped us to kind of refine and iterate existing methodologies in the lab, but also create some brand new ones to test content as it was being developed in parallel and try to understand how a vast array of characters, a huge cast of characters, would fit into PvP and PvE content and so on and so forth. So my goals for the next 20 minutes or so is to present some challenges that the user research team faced, as well as some case studies and examples of data and some methods to help illustrate how we met those challenges and how we innovated. And my real goal is to communicate some lessons learned that are broadly applicable, hopefully, to everybody in this room, especially if you're kind of getting into this for the first time. So what is Battleborn? Some of you may be aware of what Battleborn is because of Twitter, but I'm going to go through it right now. Battleborn, first and foremost, is a game about characters. It's a game that's shipped with 25 playable characters and a bunch more in DLC. It's a game where you play these characters in a whole lot of PvP, so different PvP game modes. There's a whole bunch of story missions that you can play by yourself or with other people. There's loot, because what would a Gearbox game be without a whole bunch of loot? And of course, there's a bunch of growth. So growth in this game occurs in a variety of different ways and a variety of different cycles and cadences, some within the context of a story mission or a PvP match, others outside the game, so meta growth in a variety of ways. And really, our goal was to try to understand how all of these different pieces fit together. So I'm going to talk about three major challenges following on Stephanie's approach to Doom. The first is how characters fit into this. So how we go about testing all these characters in all of these different modes and maps, and kind of understand balance and parity in different ways. Second step is navigating content, but not in the same way that Stephanie talked about. She's talking about navigation in a literal sense. We're going to be talking about it in a more metaphorical sense, navigating through content that combines story missions, PvP, and meta growth. Lastly, integrating data from a variety of different sources. So we had the opportunity for the first time in this project to really take data from a vast array of sources, qualitative and quantitative, and merge them together with some interesting convergent results for the design team. All right, let's start off first with characters. So again, there are a lot of characters in this game. All right, we've got characters that use guns, characters that use swords, characters that use jump packs, characters that turn invisible, hit you with fists. And we had to understand from a user resource perspective how players were understanding how to use these characters, whether there was parity and balance between them, how they applied to all the different game modes. So this is where our central focus was and kind of helped us constrain and focus our efforts in all the other aspects of the game. So many of you conduct playtests, right? Our lab is not any different. The kind of bread and butter of what we do is playtesting, and for this game, it was multiplayer playtesting. So I'm going to kind of talk about a little bit about that playtesting and then illustrate some additional examples that help supplement traditional playtesting. So in this game, I mentioned before, there's growth. And one of the biggest parts of the game is character growth. And when you start playing this game, this is a kind of hero shooter game. So you are playing a character that starts off at a low level, level one. And as you grow in the course of a mission or a match, you're going to get access to ability points that you get to distribute and make your character more powerful. And we call this the growth helix in this game. It's a series of binary choices that you get to make every single time you level up that helps customize your character in different ways. Well, from a data perspective, and this is an example, this is what it looks like here for one of our characters, the support character Miko. This looks like a helix, like a DNA helix, hence the name. And this affords us an interesting opportunity to look at growth paths through this tree. Now, of course, you have binary options at every single level, but at the end of it all, when you're looking at a level 10 character, there's a distinct path, rather, through that tree. So in a little bit, I'm going to show you another version of that helix that depicts it in a slightly different fashion. But the way we got at this was primarily through playtesting. A lot of iterative playtesting in the lab, looking at all of our different characters, understanding how players were upgrading those characters in a variety of different contexts. But of course, the other aspect of growth is your meta growth outside the game. So in addition to looking at in-match growth, we also had to bring on what we called longitudinal playtesters, or playtest interns, in order for us to look at how people master those characters. So this was a big challenge for us to try to combine kind of the day-to-day iterative quick playtesting to look at a new map or a new mode or a new character as they came online, and then also contrast that with data you could only get from people who had spent a significant portion of time with the game to give you feedback on those higher level ranks, higher level meta growth, and give you that mastery level understanding that was important for the development team. So throughout all of this, we wanted to trend some character data, because again, we have a ton of characters in this game. Testing over long periods of time, many years on this project. And we want to get some kind of relative preference feedback. And for this, we actually looked to some methodology developed by EA from Plants vs. Zombies Garden Warfare, and we're inspired by them, to look at how to account for kind of relative character feedback across sessions and across participants with different experiences. So what we did is we asked players to distribute some character preference points amongst the characters they had played in a given test session. And then we normalized those points to get at the fact that some players played two characters, some players played three or four. And then we started looking at this kind of on a very gross level across sessions. And this gave the design team a quick insight, a pulse check, if you will, on how characters were kind of fitting into this large cast. So very quickly with this chart, so on the x-axis we have a bunch of characters. Of course, you're looking at different sample sizes. This is combining character tests from across a variety of scenarios. We understand there are some caveats, and I'm happy chatting about that in the Q&A. But again, this is a very quick pulse check to give the design team that immediate insight. And what you're looking at are deviations from zero. Zero means if all things are equal and I play 10 characters, I give them all the same number of points, after normalization, everything's a zero. Anything just significantly above zero means, hey, I like this character more than the others. Anything below zero is, I like them less. You'll see that that first character, Melka, has a huge preference rating. We had to stop including her in some of these reports because she's a character that everybody had to play. We realized that there was a slight problem with this methodology when we started looking at our prologue, which I'll get to in just a moment, because she was the character everybody was forced to play and therefore had to give feedback. So we had to kind of remove her from those analyses. So lesson here is that while you can give really quick insights to the dev team, make sure you infer and analyze the results and provide proper caveats and interpretation so that you don't make spurious claims or draw weird connections within your data. So we wanted to test early as well. Sometimes we wanted to test even before or in parallel to playtesting. So in parallel to playtesting or even before some characters were available and in-game. So with a cast of 25, some characters came online earlier than others. Yet the dev team still wanted to get some feedback about things like personality and lore and dialogue and VO delivery, about some of these characters that would be coming on later. So we developed some new methods in the lab to get us some early qualitative feedback on some of these characters. So I'm going to talk about two examples here. The first is a very quick and dirty test where we presented some information to participants. On the left, you have an image of one of our characters, Wrath the Swordsman, with a Likert scale of interest level, followed by some open-ended questions where players could provide some descriptors, some keywords, terms that they gleaned just from the image alone. Then, after they ran through all of the characters that we're using in this test, we repeated the process in a slightly different order, counterbalanced, of course, and wanted to present some actual in-game text that the writers and designers had created, and then get their feedback again. So, hey, now that you know something about this character, what are your thoughts? So this proved to be very, very helpful for the development team, getting a sense of what was sticking, what was grokkable about these characters, and what was not. Another example was some early VO testing that we wanted to do. So here we presented character players with character images as well as some descriptions and then six snippets of VO from their VO grid. And we wanted to get some pre and post VO feedback to get a sense of whether or not the voiceover and the dialogue and delivery matched expectations of what players thought based only on the image and on the description. This is an example of a case where if you violate expectations too much, sometimes interest can drop off a bit. Ombra is our sun priestess, one of our healer characters, yet some of her VO delivery was reported to be a little too antagonistic to the player, to come off as feeling like your traditional cleric or priest or white mage type character. So this was a really cool example from both us and for the dev team, granted with a small sample size, of how powerful some of these data can be. All right, so some lessons from testing characters. Support and supplement your traditional playtesting. I think most people in this room are familiar with and comfortable with running playtests solo, multiplayer, but if you can supplement that with some qualitative testing, even before content's really ready in-game, that can provide a more robust data set to your dev team. And then, wherever possible, utilize that traditional cross-sectional playtesting with some longitudinal testing to get at your end-game content and your mastery of things like characters. All right, now let's talk about navigating content. All right, so navigating content for us means something different than what it did for Doom and Stephanie. We're talking about navigating the actual like amount of content and the order in which you can play it. So this game has, it's shipped with three different PvP modes. There are more now. And there were a whole bunch of story missions along with a prologue. So the number of ways you could play through this content varied significantly based on your own playstyle and your experiences. So we knew that the prologue was going to be important. So we did test that quite a bit. I mentioned before that we had to remove some character feedback because we knew we were playtesting the prologue often by itself or in conjunction with another mission to look at player learning and tutorial information and how they applied it to their first or second mission within that 1 hour experience. But we also knew that your path through the story missions in this game was gonna be very different based on whether or not you played it by yourself or you played it with people online. So the way the game was structured, if you played the story missions by yourself, there was a linear order. But if you played it online, then you were entered into a queue and you voted on which mission you wanted to play. Now, this was a constraint presented to us that we then kind of had to understand and provide feedback on within the context of player testing. So the real challenge here is that every single mission from a user research standpoint could feasibly be, whoa, that's weird. I don't know what that is. Could feasibly be the first mission that a player plays after their prologue. So we had to approach testing these missions in a variety of different ways. Unsurprisingly, we utilized things like A/B testing, where after your prologue, we gave you the opportunity to play one of two different missions. We would vary this within subject, between subject, and we would look at feedback and level of understanding. And this actually helped the development team determine which of these two missions, the Edge of the Void on the left and the algorithm on the right, would be the first mission in that actual linear order based on the complexity of the content, and spoiler alert, it's the algorithm. We also took this approach, where we wanted to combine story content and PvP content, knowing full well that based on early feedback that we got, as well as design intent, that players were intended to play this content in a variety of different orders. So we wanted to experience that and simulate that in the lab as closely as possible to match that real-world experience, so that any feedback that we were getting from players was actionable and understood by the dev team. So we would often start with the algorithm, which would be the first mission you'd play by yourself, the assumption being, all right, I'm a new player. I'm going to sit down and play the prologue by myself as this game is downloading, and then I'm going to go play the first mission because that's the first thing available to me. Okay, I've done that. Now what do I do? Well, then we started counterbalancing and playing with the order of content. We would go PvP and story, or do half story, then all PvP. And we did this repeatedly throughout the development of the project to get a sense of all the different ways and all the different combinatorics we could find that would reflect player profiles and player archetypes. Now, of course, at the outset of this talk, we said we were testing all the things. The realistic, the answer to that is that we couldn't. If we were going to be testing every possible combination of way you could play this game, we might still be testing it right now. So this was a way for us to get at some very specific, kind of idealized and hypothesized approaches to playing this content. This is one of my favorite examples here. All right, so that guy right there is Rendain. He's the big bad of this game, and he's the final boss. So our creature team really wanted to get some early feedback on how this fight was working. And he was in an approachable state, he was in a playable state. However, the level that he was in was not ready. So we had to figure out a way to work with the development team to get feedback on the boss without the boss's level. So we worked with them and came up with a cool solution. First, we had players go through a section of content to simulate the experience of playing this game enough to bootstrap their feedback so that they weren't going into that boss fight cold. We wanted to make sure any feedback we got on the final boss was reflective of players who had some experience with this game so that they could give us the kind of higher level feedback on the end boss fight. We then worked with development so that they embedded a warp widget, basically an interactable object in the first room of the final level that was functional, that brought us directly to the boss fight. So the lesson here is if you can work with the design team, they'll help you cheat around broken content so you can get the feedback that they really want. This worked out quite well. All right, of course, DLC testing. So I think as of last Thursday, we released the last DLC patch for the game. Advantages to testing DLC, as many of you are aware, is that you can leverage main game training and prior experience with content. So players who are coming into DLC testing, if you've screened them appropriately, they've got experience with the main game, you can forgo some of the early training. Of course, if it's been a while since they played it, you can give them a little bit of experience with the prologue or first level again, just to get their feet wet and remind them of how to play this game. However, one big caveat with testing DLC on Battleborn was that we were looking at new characters, new maps, new PvP modes. But we wanted to make sure that if we were looking at one specific piece of content, the feedback wasn't being influenced by other new content. So when it came time to testing new characters, we made sure to play those characters on maps that players were familiar with. Vice versa, if we were playing new maps, we mandated that players played characters that they were already comfortable and proficient with. So we never crossed the stream, so to speak. That ensured that we were able to isolate that feedback and make heads or tails of it. All right, quick recap here. So use A/B in counterbalance designs. This is experimental design 101, but it actually works. If you can't test everything, let the design of the game and intent guide your focus and your prioritization. And if part of your content's not ready, again, see if design can help you cheat and come up with unique solutions. And then, of course, combine DLC with some old content to leverage the experience of your players and focus the new feedback on what you want them to give feedback on. All right, challenge number 3, data integration. So throughout the development of this game, we were seeing some interesting developments in our backend systems and some of our data telemetry. And a lot of those systems were maturing alongside the development of Battleborn. This gave us as the user research team a unique opportunity to leverage these developer tools, repurpose some of them, co-opt them whole cloth in some cases, and leverage them to give new insights back to the dev team. And this is talking about some convergent results and new views on data. So the first thing that we're really happy about is some gameplay streaming. Many of you here in this room likely have solutions similar to this, where you can stream gameplay from your user research labs or facilities out to developers at their workstations. This was a brand new thing for us with Battleborn, and it has worked out marvelously. This gives the developers a unique, real-time insight into what players are doing on their levels. And we've used this to great extent at Gearbox with this project and other projects. So we're really happy with this. The second thing, this is a tool that came to us from a really unique source, the Artificial Intelligence Group. They were developing it as a tool for developers to look at kind of how players and early dev tests were working. This is a bird's eye view of some very early maps in the game. The iconography depicts player characters and some AI bots, and this was helping the developers understand how the bots were navigating and working with nav meshes and so on and so forth. However, it was a really useful tool for getting a bird's eye view on what players were doing in real time. So we ended up co-opting this entire tool for our purposes to give some real-time insights into our playtests. This was even before the streaming solution I just mentioned was fully operational. And what was really cool about this is that it also collected some basic telemetry from what players were doing. We could glean some great stuff from this, like skill uses across matches. And you'll notice that the x-axis on that left-hand chart is a percentage of match time. This is a really cool metric that the team came up with to kind of help compress and rubber band matches that were of differing times, differing time lengths rather. This allowed us to look at an aggregate data set in a different way than we were normally used to. On the right-hand side, we're looking at player archetype or character archetype lifespan prior to death. So when you spawn in the game, based on your character archetype, an attacker, supporter, defender, how long did you last typically? And these were data that we collected directly from that match viewer. Again, never intended to be used for user research purposes. It gave us what we needed, which in turn gave the developers what they needed. There are a number of back-end support systems in place for deploying experiences, matchmaking experiences, and different ways of playing the game. And it was also very useful for us because it allowed us to look at character and player profiles over a long period of time. This gave us plenty of extra flexibility in how we ran our longitudinal tests. We didn't have to always pulse check players directly on, hey, what command rank are you? What's your meta level? How many matches have you played today? We could get that directly from the game using these back-end systems that the production team and design teams were using for their own purposes. Again, turn that back around, give it right back to the developers, gives them more insights. All right, there's that Helix image again from Miko. So we had, for the very first time, the opportunity to use in-game telemetry visualization. As many of you know, telemetry can be very noisy. It takes a scalpel to kind of understand and parse and then report on what telemetry is really important. So we knew, of course, that the binary Helix options, those binary choices that you're making as a player, were going to be very, very important for the developers. We wanted to understand, hey, if you're given a choice, left or right, what is that choice? And then at the next level, based on what you chose previously, how are you going to upgrade your character again? So we were able to use, in this case, Tableau, to develop some great dashboards that give you a quick snippet, or snapshot rather, of what players were selecting. So these pie charts on the right, forgive me for using pie charts, I know that we're not supposed to do anymore, the pie charts show you the distribution of selections, left versus right, orange versus blue, of those Helix, those upgrade options at each level. It showed us where players were ignoring some options. It helped the development team kind of update, patch, and tweak and balance some of those Helix options throughout the course of development. And we're continuing to use this now as the game is live. And we use this and pulse out dashboards every single week to the dev team. All right, so lessons here. Look to developer tools and non-traditional resources wherever you can. Combine your vectors of analysis. Convergent results is probably something I say a lot in the lab. The team's probably sick of me here saying that. But convergent data is your best friend. If you get the same answer from four or five sources, then you're good to go. And then work with the dev teams. Use their tools, help them understand what you need from them, and they'll meet you halfway to give them greater insights. So again, just to reiterate, these are the big three challenges: character testing, navigating the many, many paths through the content in Battleborn, and integrating data from multiple sources. And while I won't necessarily read all of these out loud, this is, I guess, the picture moment, if you're going to snap, take a picture of the slide. But these were the ways that we kind of answered the call and the challenges presented by this game. Leave that up there for just a second. Cool. All right, a little bit more about us. So this is how you can reach us. And reach us over email or Twitter. Oh, yeah, that's right. Yeah, I have one tweet to my name. And a former colleague actually called me out on that on Twitter one time. That was embarrassing. Yeah, maybe I'll tweet about this. Yeah. All right, so we're happy answering questions. We have plenty of time for that. That's one of the reasons why we want to do this together. So I think the microphone is right over there. And thank you all very much for your attention and time.
Thanks for your presentation. Could you talk about recruitment for a minute? You said you shared a lot of players.
We are very lucky that there are a ton of college campuses within like a 50-mile radius of both of our labs. Yeah. So we go canvass the campuses with flyers at the start of every semester. We go to midnight launches at major retailers to get, you know, gamers who are currently pre-ordering and actively playing. And we just talk to people.
Yeah, we're very lucky at Gearbox. Well, we have a great database. People can apply to be part of our recruitment database directly from our website. Of course, there's a volunteer bias with that. We understand that what the issues are there. But yeah, we because we're co-located in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, and because we have kind of similar game spaces, you know, first-person shooters for the most part, we do share a playtesting pool. There will be cases where a playtester will show up in our lab on Wednesday and said, hey, do you know Stephanie down at IT? I'm like, yes, I know Stephanie down at IT. Like, oh, I was there yesterday. I'm like, don't tell me what you playtested. You have a separate NDA with both of us. Don't screw that up.
Also, we cross-promote.
We do cross-promote, yeah. We, you know,
playtest for these guys.
Yeah, we do that quite a bit. And, you know, we talk where we can. But, yeah, our recruitment is primarily volunteer-based. We do a lot of screening to make sure that we're getting the right people in at the right time. But yeah, the confluence of being in a major metropolitan area with a bunch of colleges, there are a lot of video game programs as well. There's an arts and technology program at one of the universities nearby. It spawns a lot of interest in what we do. And then you've also worked at SMU.
Yeah.
Yeah. Stephanie taught for, you can, we're sharing.
Yeah, I also teach part-time at one of the local colleges that has a master's program in game design.
You get one question. One. Make it good.
So if we go back to the Battleborn affective measurement, where they use the three text boxes to have people fill in how they felt about a character,
yeah.
Did you have pre-existing metrics for success for that from the team, or did you guys do that in more of an exploratory fashion to
Much
see what
more,
happened?
Oh, sorry. You may finish.
That was the end.
We have a rapport, guys. It's okay. That was exploratory. That was very early in development, and that was when a majority of the characters, some of whom actually never made it into the final game, that's when a lot of characters were ready for some early feedback from the creative director and the writers, and they wanted to understand what was hitting, what was sticking. So we deliberately left those keyword sections open-ended, and of course we culled the most frequently mentioned keywords, phrases, descriptors, and sent that right up as high-level feedback. And that pre and post analysis where it's like, hey, interest before, descriptors, interest after, that was also done in an exploratory sense.
Okay, did you ever use that methodology going forward for things like after they played the game, after they'd seen the player in the character in combat, things like that?
We did in a slightly different way. I didn't have an image for this. I didn't want to get too much into this one. But with some of our longitudinal testing late in the game, when players had an opportunity to play through content for a week at a time, we did some multidimensional scaling work where we actually had players kind of collectively as a group place characters on a two-dimensional space that was kind of a complexity and like interest space to try to map where these characters were falling, where the centroids were, who was skewing to the middle, who was skewing to the outskirts. And that was pretty useful late in the game as it was like, okay, how are we going to market this? How are we going to position some of this content?
Okay, excellent. Thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Hi, I had a question about the character stuff that you did where you had like points mm-hmm. that you normalize. Yep. Was that like you told them they had so many points.
Yes.
Okay.
So how'd that work?
How'd you determine how many points to
So it was an even 100 points, and they had to distribute those points to all the characters they played. So within the context of our survey, they selected which characters they played from the cast available. And if they had four characters, for example, that they played, then they had to distribute those 100 points amongst four characters. Now, the reason we normalized that was because if you, for example, played four characters and Jordan played three, well, he may have given each one of his characters 33 points and you gave each of yours 25, but at the end of the day, that's the same thing. It means you've equated those characters, which is why we normalize them based on the number of characters played, which is why that the y-axis midpoint is zero. So zero indicates kind of the null hypothesis of, A, all things being equal, we feel equally about these characters.
Okay, mm-hmm. Thank you.
So I had a question regarding your white mage character that you had initially negative feedback towards because mm-hmm. of her characterization, right? Did you have to completely rewrite like her character type after that?
So the development team was able to use some of the feedback to kind of alter some aspects of the character, but much of that, in fact, kind of remained the same in slightly different context. It was more informative for them as far as, again, some marketing positioning components of the game, as well as, hey, how do we go about showcasing this character in the context of trailers and actually in-game? So when you're playing this, when you play the character, do your feelings change or not? By and large, you know, people who played the character afterwards had more positive things to say than if you just experienced your VO.
Oh, okay.
Mm-hmm.
Cool, because a snappy white mage sounds awesome.
She has one of my favorite lines in the game. It's about shirts being tucked in, and I'll leave it at that. Yeah.
So with Doom and your first challenge, you mentioned you found two player types, the old school versus the new school. Did you end up screening for specific ones for different playtests, or did you end up bringing in whoever and then finding out via survey which they fit into?
So we did that. We do keep a log of which Doom titles players have played, but sometimes our database gets out of date, especially with like free games on Xbox Live or Steam sales. So we would always rescreen when sending out invites. And if we got responses back from a majority of players who said they've only played Doom 3, we could alter our methodology prior to players coming in. We would try to split it evenly, but sometimes we couldn't get an even sample within our testing groups. And then we also would validate that information by having them describe what's their favorite. If you said you played Doom 1, what is your favorite map? What is your favorite thing about Doom 1? If you played Doom 3, what's your favorite map? What's your favorite thing? So we could further validate that they actually played Doom 1 or Doom 2, or they actually may have played Doom 3, but they think it was Doom 1.
What if they only saw the movie?
That was a valid screening criteria as well.
Hi guys, thanks again for the talk. It was really, really informative on both sides. Quick question, going back to you're mentioning you typically recruit players from some kind of more game design college. Do you guys see any difference with those profiles or anything that you have to account for that you need to be careful of?
Actually, we think, well, I don't know if John feels the same way, but I think it's a huge benefit because we're able to bring people in for earlier playtests. We can test gray box maps or prototypes where not all of the feedback is in. And since they're familiar with how game development works, at least on a basic level, it makes it easier for them to see past some of the incomplete features and just give better feedback for that.
For us, it's kind of a double-edged sword. On a positive, exactly what Stephanie said, right? They understand a little bit more about the fact that games take a while to come online and you could test a bit earlier. Also, they understand the gravity of an NDA. If they're looking to get into that industry, they're not going to screw that up. On the flip side, some of them are looking for jobs and, well, we want to get feedback. We don't want to hire them right then and there. And then at the same time, they don't always represent the cross-section of customers that we're really trying to reach. So if you just recruit people or you just get people in from those programs, you may be getting a skewed perspective. Now that's also coming from somebody who did a whole lot of psychology research for many years and understands full well that the vast majority of what we know about human cognition comes from like 18 to 22 year olds in universities. So there are caveats in every single instance when you're recruiting from a sample of the population. Okay. Just know what you're getting and account for it. That's my motto.
I'm sorry if I missed this before, but on the character stuff, you're talking about balancing the game. In terms of somebody's positive impression about a character, how much of that was because it might have felt even OP to them versus, you know, the character makeup of the, you know, aesthetics?
Oh, yeah. So there were some characters that were absolutely OP. I can speak a little bit to this. We did some kind of early closed tactical events, closed tactical tests and open beta. And there were certain characters based on telemetry we were getting that were absolutely powerful. But one of the advantages of this game, with all those back-end systems that I mentioned that were developed in parallel to the game, was an unprecedented level of interaction between the designers, the community, and the game itself. So on a weekly basis, the game can be micro-patched, can be patched up, and those balance changes can actually kind of bring characters back in line. This goes for underpowered characters as well. That said, in playtesting, yeah, you're going to have positive experiences from characters that you kick the snot out of people with. That's understandable. The goal is, of course, given the constraints of the test, if we were looking for feedback on, say, one particular character, was that character fun to play with, as in you yourself playing that character, fun to play with as an ally, and also fun to play against? Because if a character's not fun to play against at all in a PvP context, then the design team needs to address that as well. So when we were testing some of our DLC characters, we ensure that everybody had an opportunity to play that character at least once, but then provide feedback as an ally and as an opponent to ensure that we got all aspects of that character makeup.
Can I have one more question? Sorry. and then you might have a similar challenge that I have, which is VO tends to have deadlines that are far in advance of everything else. Yeah. How do you guys handle that? I will relinquish the microphone.
So yes, that's an absolute truism. Sometimes, even if you get feedback on a character's, you know, VO, it's too late. That's an unfortunate reality of what we do as a living. However, again, there are ways of kind of couching VO within gameplay that kind of helps assuage some of those concerns on the players. And again, speaking to Ombra, our Sun Priestess character, you know, we had some early feedback that she was kind of abrasive, but that ended up being fine once players got their hands on playing with her quite a bit. In fact, she was a very powerful character for quite some time, so that also helped. But yeah, that's a reality that I think everybody in this room has or will eventually face, is you've got some feedback, but unfortunately, because of the way production works, it's sometimes too late, and you kind of need to be cool with that. And sometimes you can file that away. What's your saying? You file it away for the sequel, right, 70? Or you file it away for lessons learned on future games or other ways to iterate your methods going forward.
Speaking of, what is the most important way you guys are taking away to iterate going forward? What's the most important change or improvement that you took away from this flow?
For us, it's the quality of telemetry. You know, going forward in all of our projects, telemetry is a huge deal. This game gave... Why is this thing falling? All right, cool. This game gave designers, again, an unprecedented look at data from a variety of sources, and now they want it all the time, which is great. But it means that we need to double down on that. And we need to improve our methods, we need to iterate, we need to further establish what the goals are for using telemetry earlier in the game so that it's less noisy later on. Because if you collect data on literally everything, then it takes forever to query things. Sometimes you crash the database. It takes forever to interpret. David, yeah, you understand this. That's probably our biggest takeaway.
Yeah, I think for us, additional sources of data, like it's one thing to have the player's opinion and then a subset of in-game metrics. There's certain things that you just can't get from game metrics that you have to get the player to say verbally or in written form. I think with us, it was sometimes you need to do more in-depth probing and just talk to players longer.
Cool, thanks.
So I have a question about Doom, because you have the two kind of buckets of gamers, old school versus new school. Could you talk a little bit about presenting those findings, say, to your design team? Because you want a game that everyone likes, right? So did you tell them, so this was feedback and these were from these like old school 90s players versus the new school, and yeah.
Absolutely, and it was layers of caveats upon caveats. Like, this player played Doom, but not Doom 2, and then played Doom 3 in 2012. So we took a look at the timeline for different player perspectives and just made sure that we gave the dev team context. We knew what the dev team wanted to make with that game. We also wanted to make sure that they were okay with how players would perceive some of those decisions. So we just tried to give them as much information and context as possible. Okay. Yeah, we're good.
Thank you, everybody.
Thank you.
Yeah, we did it. Yay.